if you think about where we started on Wednesday morning, we started with identifying what a startup company is and specifically contrasting it with a small business. And we determined that for our purposes and within this practice area, a startup company is a company that tends to be product and not service focused. It tends to have a significant intellectual property component, which means it's primarily a tech company or probably a tech company or a biotech company. That tends to represent the heart and soul and guts of a startup company. Furthermore, traditionally, startup companies like this choose an active growth trajectory, hyper growth. They're not emphasizing revenues or even profitability so much. What they're really focused on is product development, research and development. They are interested in acquiring market share and proof of concept and demonstrating to the world that they've got something here. And in some respects, that means getting big pretty fast, certainly out ahead of the business model, which would represent revenues and profitability. But the thinking is that we're not building these businesses to try to achieve near-term profitability. We're building these businesses to look attractive over the long haul to a potential buyer. So a potential buyer shows up and says, we see that you've been losing money, but we believe that we can take this company that you've created, snap it into our existing corporate structure, and turn it into a profit-making machine. And that's what's attractive about these particular startups. It's important to lay that framework because the sorts of counsel and advice and decisions that we're gonna make moving forward very much are driven and informed by the type of business we're working with. And the first place that shows up is with choice of entity. We're not gonna be looking at S corporations, notwithstanding the fact that S corporations can be the perfect choice for many small businesses in America. But here it's a problem because of the restrictions and the inflexibility that it lays on top of the cap table. What we found was the Delaware C Corp works really well. Delaware works well because historically it's become the state that most people favor. The laws are flexible and work well, and people just understand it and they're comfortable with the law there. The C corporation structure works because in the world we occupy, we like the fact that our venture capital investors aren't going to have trouble investing in us. They do have trouble investing in pass-through entities, which most LLCs are. And that's really our competitor here when we're choosing an entity. But we don't want the tax-exempt limited partners of venture capital funds to have trouble. We don't want their foreign investors to have trouble. They typically do if the investment is being made in a pass-through entity. We solve that with the Delaware C Corp. We also get to take advantage of different sorts of equity compensation approaches, and we talked about those. We talked about Section 422 of the Internal Revenue Code allowing us to issue incentive stock options. We have to comply with the requirements and the criteria, but they can be very powerful compensatory tools and tax-advantaged instruments to put in the hands of our employees. Now, we can still award non-qualified stock options to other service providers around our entity. 409A requires that they be priced at current fair market value, generally speaking, and they're not quite as optimal from a tax perspective as an ISO might be, but we have a broader universe of people that we can issue and award them to, and it's available to us. And certainly that sort of equity compensation program is simpler and more elegant to put in place in a C corporation than it is in an LLC. We can do it in an LLC, but it's just more challenging. We also found that with a C corporation, as it relates to exits, there are advantages. Generally speaking, if you're going public, you're going public as a C corporation. So if you're already a C corporation, you're teed up for that. Certainly you could convert if you're an LLC, but why go to that hassle and trouble, particularly if you're gonna be raising venture capital along the way. So from an IPO perspective, you've positioned yourself well. The other piece of it is that when you're thinking about exits, we noted that an asset deal is particularly devastating for C corporations. That's where that double taxation really gets you. And that's where you would prefer to be a pass-through entity. That's where the LLC taxed as a partnership really pays. But what we learned is that the buyers of companies in this space know this, and they're sensitive to that. And notwithstanding the fact that an asset deal is often very advantageous for tax and liability reasons for a buyer, buyers here are generally comfortable acquiring the stock of the selling entity, whether through a stock purchase or through a merger. And in particular, if it's a merger, we can oftentimes take advantage of Section 368 of the Internal Revenue Code, set it up as a tax-free reorganization, and not only do we get the benefit of one layer of tax because we're disposing stock, but we can actually defer some of that tax, we can kick it down the road through the benefit that's offered to us by Section 368. Finally, we noted that we really like this C corporation formula and format because of Section 1202. If we comply with the rules, which are generally easy to comply with, particularly in the early days before we get too big, if you hold that stock for 5 years, you do not pay taxes on the sale of the stock. And it's a huge windfall to the holder. Not only do you get the benefit, it's not just a matter of long-term capital gains, it's basically zero capital gains. You do not pay tax on the gain if you've held it for at least 5 years. The issue, though, is Section 1202 is only available for C corporations. And that's a massive advantage for C corporations vis-a-vis LLC's tax as a partnership. So we evolved from there, and then we talked about how do you actually form a Delaware corporation. And we walked through filing the certificate of incorporation to bring it into existence. We showed how we have that initial action by the sole incorporator where we adopt bylaws and elect the board. Then we have the meeting of the board. The board actually adopts and approves a subscription agreement. Frequently, it's a stock restriction agreement. That's the way we get stock into the hands of the founders. They elect the officers. These are the people that run the show. Then we looked at that stock restriction agreement. And what we found was, is typically it includes a vesting provision because we want to motivate these founders to stick around. Now, the issue with vesting is that in theory, you don't pay tax on the benefit that you just received with that stock until that vesting takes place. It's considered to be a substantial risk of forfeiture, and you don't have to pay the tax until that substantial risk of forfeiture goes away, until it lapses. In other words, when you vest. That seems good. But the bad is that if it vests at a point in time where the stock is worth a lot, you now have to pay tax on that new value. Instead, if you make an 83B election under Section 83B, if you file it within 30 days of your date of award, what the IRS lets you do is accelerate that tax liability to today, which seems bad, but it's good because the value is super low. So your stock restriction agreement is going to outline the vesting for founder stock. Because it's vesting, you need to think in your head immediately, we want to make an 83B election and we got to get that filed within 30 days. It's really important because it can be devastating from a tax perspective if you lose that opportunity. We also talked about the invention assignment agreement. Oftentimes they're called a proprietary information and invention assignment agreement. It's a critical document for the company. We want the founders to sign it. We're going to ask every employee to sign it. And we're going to ask everybody who creates anything for the company to sign it, who works for the company in any capacity, independent contractors, consultants, or otherwise. They've got to keep confidential information confidential. Very importantly, whatever they invent in the way of intellectual property, could be patents, could be trademarks, could be copyrights, could be trade secrets, could be know-how, could be ideas, could be anything within this massive basket of intellectual property. If they were involved in the creation of it, they agree to assign it to the company. The company owns it. Crucial, because as we said at the beginning, that intellectual property is definitional. It's existential to this startup company. It makes it a startup company. And while, generally speaking, the IP created by founders and employees is by default owned by the company, we certainly want to be sure of that, and the contract makes it certain. But with contractors and consultants, the concern there is that perhaps the IP actually lives in their hands. They've got title to the IP, notwithstanding the fact that we paid them for it. And the default rule is often, and oftentimes, that IP title stays with them. So we want to ensure that they assign us the IP so we own our IP. And we walk through those agreements and that documentation. We talked about the securities laws. And we talked about how whenever you're selling stock, you're selling a security. Options are a security. Warrants are a security. Convertible promissory notes are a security. Safes are a security. You've got to comply with the securities laws at both the federal and the state level. You've got to be sensitive to that. We focused on Section 4A2, which is a statutory exemption. We like it because it's very flexible and because the standard is sophistication, which is a little bit softer. But if you go down that path, you really got to be sensitive to the state securities laws. Rule 504 under Reg D, we like it because it really doesn't matter if you're accredited or not accredited, and the disclosure obligations aren't that high. You can only raise up to $5 million. But again, one thing you need to be sensitive to, state securities laws. And because it's inside of Reg D, you gotta file a Form D. You may lose your stealthiness by filing that Form D and alerting the world that you're out there. 506B, that's the old 506. You can raise an unlimited amount of money. That's wonderful. If you limit yourself to accredited investors, very little disclosure. You can have up to 35 non-accredited investors, but if you do that, you've really gotta up your disclosure game. You have to file a Form D. That's kind of a bummer. Good news on the accredited investor front, you can self-certify. Simply say you're accredited, and if you as the issuer have reason to believe that that's true, you don't have to do any extra digging. You don't have to go deep on that. You can take their word for it. On the state securities law front, good news with Rule 506. Thanks to NISMIA, don't need to comply. We preempt the application of the state securities laws with Rule 506. Which takes us to Rule 506C, which is the new innovation, where we can generally solicit, which is fantastic. Recall that under 4A2, 504, and 506B, no general solicitation, which means we can't leverage social media, which is a big problem for a lot of these companies. They want to leverage social media to pitch their offering. You can't do it under those other exemptions, but you can with 506C. The trade-off is you can only sell securities to accredited investors, and self-certification doesn't cut it. Okay, they've got to provide some kind of objective third-party-ish validation or verification that they are accredited. Investors don't like doing that. They're resistant to doing it. And notwithstanding the benefit and the opportunity of general solicitation, that requirement and obligation around accreditation has really limited its effectiveness. We touched briefly on Reg A Plus and Reg CF. Just good to know that they exist. But from a traditional fundraising perspective, we don't use those and leverage those a lot in startup land. So this is then where we started to make that pivot from what we're doing inside of a startup company to actually raising money. And we start with the seed stage. And we talked about how the seed stage exists in that period of time between the literal organization of the company and your first venture capital financing, which is typically designated as your Series A. And that period of time might be 3 days, 3 weeks, 3 months, 3 years, 30 years. But any financing that takes place in there, friends and family, angels, seed investors, really early stage VCs that might drift in, that's a seed deal. Seed deals can certainly take place in seed preferred, and frequently do. But we identified the convertible promissory note as an instrument by which many of these deals get done. And originally that happened, it emerged from the dot-com era because we were struggling with negotiating valuations that everyone could agree with. And the convertible promissory note gave us a way to get a deal done without actually pricing the round. Because recall, whenever you sell stock, in order to get a price per share, you have got to determine a valuation. And if you can't determine a valuation, you can't determine a price per share. And if you can't determine a price per share, you can't determine the number of shares you're selling, which means that you can't make an entry on the cap table, which means you don't know what the ownership percentages are, which means when it comes time to sell the company and distribute the proceeds, you don't know who gets what. And that's a mess, and we don't like that. So if you're struggling with valuation, you can't sell stock, but you can do a convertible promissory note. And they came out of the late 90s to solve that problem. Principal is the amount invested. There's an interest rate, typically 8%. And what we saw happen was there was a maturity date as well, oftentimes 18 to 24 months. And you need that interest rate and you need that maturity date in order to ensure that this is indeed debt and it's required and we can't get out from underneath that. Over time, there was the introduction of the discount to give a nod to the investors who held these notes to say, we know that you came in before that converting event and you ought to get a little bit of benefit from that. Typically the discount is 20%. Later on was the introduction of the cap, which said, look, under no circumstances am I converting at a price higher than the price that is calculated on the basis of this cap. In the convertible note world, typically the cap is a pre-money valuation cap. When we're talking about safes, which we're gonna get to in a sec, it used to be a pre-money valuation cap, but Y Combinator has changed their template to make it a post-money valuation cap, and a lot of people are following that in the safe world. But on the convertible note side, you still typically see it as a pre-money figure. The point being primarily, you just gotta be attentive to it. I mentioned safes. SAFEs, of course, are the third way that we can raise seed capital. A SAFE looks like a convertible note, walks like a convertible note, quacks like a convertible note. The only real difference is no interest rate, get out from underneath all that tax complexity, and no maturity date, because it gives too much artificial leverage to the investor. At least that was determined by Y Combinator and the founders that really like SAFEs. By definition, though, a SAFE can't be debt. No interest rate, no maturity date, you're not debt. So what does that mean that it is? It's equity. Well, what kind of equity? Well, it's a right to acquire stock. What does that mean? It means it's an option. It's a warrant. It's a right to acquire stock, just like an option and just like a warrant. What's a little bit different from the options that we were just talking about a couple minutes ago is that you pay the money up front. So typically with an option, you pay the exercise price, you pay the purchase price at the moment in time you're acquiring the stock. With a SAFE, you pay it up front, and then you just wait for that conversion event, and then that's when you actually get your stock issued. From seed financings, we transitioned into venture capital financings. The venture capital world we saw is very structured in terms of how it approaches these transactions. It used to be far more free-flowing from a transactional perspective. Forms and terms varied highly, geography to geography, firm to firm, venture firm to venture firm. But there's been a heavy normalization over the last 25 years, driven primarily by the National Venture Capital Association, the NVCA, and the model documents that they've published. We led with the term sheet and spent a ton of time on the term sheet, and then we got into the other five documents. The term sheet, as we know, is the non-binding expression of intent. This is what we plan on doing, and this is where we get into the deal. And this is where we start to see what sort of shape this preferred stock is going to take. We talked about how preferred stock in this world tends to be focused on two categories of rights: economic rights and control rights. On the economic side, as a general rule of thumb, preferred moves to common on a one-to-one basis. So they show up the same way on the cap table. One share means one share means one share means one share when it comes to ownership percentage, which means when it comes to the overlay on the net proceeds in a transaction. Now, we did note that that can be tweaked in the case of a down round, okay? If there's some kind of down round protection, could be a full ratchet, but probably it's going to be weighted average. There might be an adjustment made to that ratio in order to insulate the preferred from the full weight of that bad dilution. But that's the only time where you're really going to see a deviation from that one-to-one economic ratio. But the more significant economic piece to pay attention to is what happens in liquidation. And we were clear to note that liquidation is not just a bad liquidation, but it's also M&A events. And this is where we get to participating preferred versus non-participating preferred. With non-participating preferred, the general rule of thumb is you either get your money back, and that's expressed as a liquidation preference. Typically, it's 1x what you paid. That's your money back. Or you just take what your ownership percentage is. You play like you play on the cap table. So in a good outcome, you look just like common stock. In a bad outcome, you've got that downside protection and you have a way to get at least some of your money back, perhaps all of it back before anyone else. Participating preferred, that's a different beast. That's and. There's no choice to be made. There's no greater of. You get both. You get your money back, and then you also get your percentage of the proceeds based upon the shares that you own. Founders tend not to like it. They sometimes call it double dipping. It's something that can get hotly negotiated, and we've talked about how increasingly we've seen it fall out of favor. Over the last 10 years, non-participating preferred has been a beast existing not just in Northern California, but it has seeped and spread and has become the norm throughout the rest of the country. But query, when the next downturn arises, are we going to see participating preferred come back on the scene? And certainly, I would anticipate that we would one way or the other. We talked about dividends. We talked about the difference between declaring a dividend, which really doesn't happen in this context, versus dividends that accrue or dividends that are cumulative or that accumulate. Those work like interest, tends to be 8%. That's where our 8% interest rate came from with convertible notes, because of this 8% dividend context in preferred stock. If it's cumulative or accrued, it's going to roll year after year after year, and that can be powerful. It gets added to the liquidation preference, and your 1x goes to a 1x plus accrued dividends. And if it's 8% over 5 years, it's 40%. So now it's really 1.4x. So it's a way to really kind of juice up that liquidation preference. Typically, if you have participating preferred, you're going to see a cumulative dividend. flip side, if you have non-participating preferred, you're likely not to see that kind of a dividend at all, or if you do, it'll be a non-cumulative dividend, which for the most part never gets activated, so it's not much of a concern. The final piece that we noted, and this is more of a cultural piece, that you find typically that companies that have participating preferred, they stack. There's the A, and then the B is on top, and then the C is on top, and then the D is on top. If you're in a company with non-participating preferred, typically the culture is pari passu, which means everyone's at the same level. A plus B plus C plus D. We noted that this makes no difference for the founders. They're in common, they're underneath that stack, they don't see a penny until all that gets paid. Where it matters is it matters for the VCs. And it matters in particular if you're in a middling outcome or a down outcome or a bad outcome situation. If you are, if you're at the top of the stack, there's a better probability that you're gonna get paid first, okay? So if you're the A, you're in trouble. Pari passu, it gets spread across the group on a pro rata basis. The A starts to play right away. Nobody's gonna get all their money, but at least everybody gets something. And that's the way the stacking versus the pari passu approach plays. We then moved into the control and governance rights that attach to preferred. They get to vote with common stock, they typically get a board seat, and they get these things called protective provisions, which are veto rights, they're blocking rights. They're ways to ensure that certain transactions can't get done, that certain actions can't be taken without their consent. They do not give them the ability to catalyze or to act affirmatively, but they give them the opportunity to block. And some of those protective provisions are highly typical, and you see them in every deal. And sometimes those provisions can change transaction to transaction to transaction, company to company to company, just depending upon their importance in the eyes of the beholder. We then actually moved into the transaction documents themselves. We looked at the term sheet. As I mentioned, it's the non-binding expression of interest, which talks about the key terms, and then those ultimately get translated in the deal documents. The most important deal document, the certificate of incorporation. We're gonna amend and restate it because we actually have to create that preferred stock and we have to give it shape in accordance with the term sheet and in accordance with the transaction. And we bake all these rights into it. The certificate of incorporation gets filed immediately before the transaction is consummated. We need the stock available to sell, which means we need to create it to sell it. Then we have the stock purchase agreement. It handles our logistics. It's our subscription document for purposes of selling a security. It also includes reps and warranties. It's the place where our investors make the representations that we need them to make under the securities laws. It's also the place where the company makes representations. We doubt that these will ever really be enforced, even if the company is ultimately found to have not complied completely with the reps and warranties, but they're still useful because they act as a diligence tool. It's a way for the investor to tease out information from the company in the way that they need so that they can feel comfortable about the investment they're getting ready to make. We talked about how the stock purchase agreement really plays as of the moment of investment and then looking backwards as it relates to reps and warranties. The other three documents are our going forward documents that are filled with covenants and going forward obligations. The investor rights agreement, the right of first refusal and co-sale agreement, and the voting agreement. The investor rights agreement includes registration rights. We talked about how these are very technical and rarely used. More importantly, it's where we cover information rights, potentially observation rights at the board level, so that our stockholders, our preferred stockholders, have some extra access to information. And it's where we have preemptive rights or pro rata rights or the right to participate in future issuances so you can continue to play and maintain your ownership percentage as an investor if you want to. That's a pretty significant right. We also saw that the investor rights agreement includes the ability to have what in effect are director level protective provisions that would flow back to the preferred directors. Sometimes you see those in transactions, other times you don't. It's an optional provision, but this is where it sits if you pick it. The right of first refusal and co-sale agreement exists primarily to limit and put restrictions on founder stock. It's rarely complied with by the letter. Ultimately, what it does is it creates so many obstacles and so much difficulty in terms of trying to comply with it literally. It simply forces the founder to come back to the board and to come back to the preferred stockholders and ask permission to sell stock if they want to. Most founders aren't really involved in selling stock on a day-to-day basis. Occasionally, one might. This is the way that this blocks them from doing it freely, and it gives the company some voice in making sure that it's happening inside of a transaction that they're comfortable with. The voting agreement's our final agreement. And we made the case that the voting agreement next to the certificate of incorporation would be the second most important agreement that's involved in the mix here, or the second most important document. The voting agreement fills out the board structure issues, and this is where we get personal. The board structure is outlined in the certificate of incorporation at a macro level, but as it gets to the details of who has what seat where, that's in the voting agreement. We also talked about drag-along rights and how drag-along rights appear in almost every deal, and when they do, this is where they appear. They appear in the voting agreement. The drag-along rights harmonize any sort of exit transaction that we're engaging in, whether it's an asset deal or a merger or a stock sale. It ensures that the funds will flow in accordance with the liquidation mechanics that we've spent so much time negotiating and implementing. It also makes sure that the approvals and the participation that are required across these different transactional forms all harmonize. They oftentimes, in addition to giving a protective provision to the preferred stockholders, in other words, these deals can't proceed without preferred stockholder approval, they oftentimes give what is in effect a protective provision to the founders, which seems pretty unique and highly irregular in venture world, but we noted that it's not really that big of a deal because typically it's limited to the founders who are still employed by the company, and no buyer is really going to want to buy these businesses unless the founders are supportive of the transaction anyway. So it's not really that big of a concession to make. Finally, we noted that while drag-along rights are nice from the perspective of being able to pull everyone along, they must vote for the transaction or they must participate in the transaction if they're a party to this drag-along right provision. And that was really the original intent or the original objective served by this provision. In reality, it's not all that valuable because buyers want literal consent. They don't want people being dragged to the deal table. They want everyone to sign affirmatively and happily. And buyers increasingly are raising the level, raising the bar in terms of the consents and the approvals and the participation that they want from the stakeholders in these corporations. And as a final point, we emphasized that within the context of an exit transaction, it's often a heavy onus that's carried by seller to go out and not just get the bare minimum of participants required by Delaware corporation law or required by our deal documents, but we need to try to get virtually everybody, sometimes everybody, on board with this deal and participating. And that takes us to the exit event, and that takes us to the finish line, and that's everything. So in a nutshell and in a sprint, I would say that, 3 days ago, 4 days ago, you knew none of this, or maybe a little bit of it, but I hope that with this monologue, I think you kept pace with it, and I think along the way, you understood how it builds, how the information ties, and how it all fits, and how this world works. And if you caught even 50% of that, you're better than 90% of my competition. And you can start to do the math if you got more than 50% of that. So this has been an incredible sprint, a ton of information, totally fire hosed over 4 days. You guys have been amazing. I know the finals will be great. And I look forward to not just interacting with you for the balance of the day and for the next few days, but please reach out to me in the future. You're amazing people, and this has been a real honor and privilege to be with you over the last 4 days. So thank you.
Thank you so much.